Chapter 3, The Wild Wood. The mole had long wanted to make the acquaintance of the badger. He seemed, by all accounts, to be such an important personage, and, though rarely visible, to make his unseen influence felt by everybody about the place. But whenever the mole mentioned his wish to the water rat, he always found himself put off. "It's all right," the rat would say. "Badger'll turn up some day or other. He's always turning up, and then I'll introduce you, the best of fellows. But you must not only take him as you find him, but when you find him." "Couldn't you ask him here, dinner or something?" said the mole. "Oh, he wouldn't come," replied the rat simply. "Badger hates society and invitations and dinner and all that sort of thing." "Well, then, supposing we go and call on him," suggested the mole. "Oh, I'm sure he wouldn't like that at all," said the rat, quite alarmed. "He's so very shy, he'd be sure to be offended. I've never even ventured to call on him at his own home myself, though I know him so well. Besides, we can't. It's quite out of the question, because he lives in the very middle of the wild wood." "Well, supposing he does," said the mole. "You told me the wild wood was all right, you know." "Oh, I know, so it is," replied the rat evasively. "But I think we won't go there just now, not just yet. It's a long way, and he wouldn't be at home at this time of year anyhow, and he'll be coming along some day if you'll wait quietly." In the winter time, the rat slept a great deal, retiring early and rising late. During his short day, he sometimes scribbled poetry or did other small domestic jobs about the house, and of course there were always animals dropping in for a chat, and consequently there was a good deal of storytelling and comparing notes on the past summer and all its doings. There was plenty to talk about on those short winter days when the animals found themselves round the fire. Still, the mole had a good deal of spare time on his hands, and so one afternoon, when the rat in his armchair before the blaze was alternately dozing and trying over rhymes that wouldn't fit, he formed the resolution to go out by himself and explore the wildwood, and perhaps strike up an acquaintance with Mr. Badger. It was a cold, still afternoon, with a hard, steely sky overhead, when he slipped out of the warm parlor into the open air. The country lay bare and entirely leafless around him, and he thought that he had never seen so far and so intimately into the insides of things as on that winter day, when nature was deep in her annual slumber and seemed to have kicked the clothes off. Copses, dells, quarries, and all hidden places, which had been mysterious mines for exploration in leafy summer, now exposed themselves and their secrets pathetically, and seemed to ask him to overlook their shabby poverty for a while, till they could riot in rich masquerade as before, and trick and entice him with the old deceptions. It was pitiful in a way, and yet cheering, even exhilarating. He was glad that he liked the country undecorated, hard and stripped of its finery. He had got down to the bare bones of it, and they were fine and strong and simple. He did not want the warm clover and the play of seeding grasses, the screens of quickset, the billowy drapery of beech and elm seemed best away. And with great cheerfulness of spirit he pushed on toward the wild wood, which lay before him low and threatening, like a black reef in some still southern sea. There was nothing to alarm him at first entry. Twigs crackled under his feet, logs tripped him, funguses on stumps resembled caricatures, and startled him for the moment by their likeness to something familiar and far away. But that was all fun and exciting. It led him on, and he penetrated to where the light was less, and trees crouched nearer and nearer, and holes made ugly mouths at him on either side. Everything was very still now. The dusk advanced on him steadily, rapidly, gathering in behind and before, and the light seemed to be draining away like flood water. Then the faces began. It was over his shoulder, and indistinctly that he first thought he saw a face, a little evil wedge-shaped face, looking out at him from a hole. When he turned and confronted it, the thing had vanished. He quickened his pace, telling himself cheerfully not to begin imagining things, or there would be simply no end to it. He passed another hole, and another, and then, certainly a little narrow face with hard eyes had flashed up for an instant from a hole and was gone. If he could only get away from the holes in the banks, he thought, there would be no more faces. He swung off the path and plunged into the untrodden places of the wood. Then the pattering began. He thought it was only falling leaves at first, so slight and delicate was the sound of it. Then as it grew, it took a regular rhythm, and he knew it for nothing else but the pat, pat, pat of little feet. In a panic, he began to run, too, aimlessly, he knew not whither. He ran up against things, he fell over things and into things, he darted under things and dodged round things. At last he took refuge in a deep, dark hollow of an old beech tree, which offered shelter, concealment, perhaps even safety, but who could tell? Anyhow, he was too tired to run any further and could only snuggle down into the dry leaves which had drifted into the hollow and hope he was safe for a time. And as he lay there panting, trembling, and listened to the whistlings and the patterings outside, he knew it at last, in all its fullness, that dread thing which other little dwellers in field and hedgerow had encountered here, and known as their darkest moment, that thing which the rat had vainly tried to shield him from, the terror of the wild wood. Meantime, the rat, warm and comfortable, dozed by his fireside. His paper of half-finished verses slipped from his knee, his head fell back, his mouth opened, and he wandered by the verdant banks of dream rivers. Then a coal slipped, the fire crackled, and sent up a spurt of flame, and he woke with a start. Remembering what he had been engaged upon, he reached down to the floor for his verses, pored over them for a minute, and then looked round for the mole to ask him if he knew a good rhyme for something or other. But the mole was not there. He listened for a time. The house seemed very quiet. Then he called, "Moley," several times, and received no answer, got up and went out into the hall. The mole's cap was missing from its accustomed peg. His galoshes, which always lay by the umbrella stand, were also gone. The rat left the house and carefully examined the muddy surface of the ground outside, hoping to find the mole's tracks. There they were, sure enough. The galoshes were new, just bought for the winter, and the pimples on their soles were fresh and sharp. He could see the imprints of them in the mud, running along straight and purposeful, leading direct to the wild wood. The rat looked very grave, and stood in deep thought for a minute or two. Then he re-entered the house, strapped a belt round his waist, shoved a brace of pistols into it, took up a stout cudgel that stood in a corner of the hall, and set off for the wild wood at a smart pace. He made his way manfully through the length of the wood to its furthest edge, then, forsaking all paths, he set himself to traverse it laboriously, working over the whole ground, and all the time calling out cheerfully, "Moley, Moley, where are you? It's me, it's old Rat." He had patiently hunted through the wood for an hour or more, when at last, to his joy, he heard a little answering cry. Guiding himself by the sound, he made his way through the gathering darkness to the foot of an old beech tree with a hole in it, and from out of the hole came a feeble voice saying, "Ratty, is that really you?" The rat crept into the hollow, and there he found the mole, exhausted and still trembling. "Oh, rat," he cried, "I've been so frightened, you can't think." "Oh, I quite understand," said the rat soothingly. "You shouldn't really have gone and done it, mole. I did my best to keep you from it. We river bankers, we hardly ever come here by ourselves." "Now then," said the rat, "we really must pull ourselves together and make a start for home while there's still a little light left. It will never do to spend the night here, you understand. Too cold, for one thing." "Dear Ratty," said the poor mole, "I'm dreadfully sorry, but I'm simply dead beat, and that's a solid fact. You must let me rest here for a while longer and get my strength back if I'm going to get home at all." "Oh, all right," said the good-natured rat. "Rest away. It's pretty nearly pitch dark now, anyhow, and there ought to be a bit of a moon later." So the mole got well into the dry leaves and stretched himself out, and presently dropped off into sleep, though of a broken and troubled sort, while the rat covered himself up too, as best he might, for warmth, and lay patiently waiting, with a pistol in his paw. When at last the mole woke up, much refreshed and in his usual spirits, the rat said, "Now then, I'll just take a look outside and see if everything's quiet, and then we really must be off." He went to the entrance of their retreat and put his head out. Then the mole heard him saying quietly to himself, "Hello, hello, here is a go." "What's up, Ratty?" asked the mole. "Snow is up," replied the rat briefly, "or rather down. It's snowing hard." The mole came and crouched beside him, and looking out saw the wood that had been so dreadful to him in quite a changed aspect. Holes, hollows, pools, pitfalls, and other black menaces to the wayfarer were vanishing fast, and a gleaming carpet of fairy was springing up everywhere, that looked too delicate to be trodden upon by rough feet. A fine powder filled the air and caressed the cheek with a tingle in its touch, and the black boles of the trees showed up in a light that seemed to come from below. "Well, well, it can't be helped," said the rat, after pondering. "We must make a start and take our chances, I suppose. The worst of it is, I don't exactly know where we are, and now this snow makes everything look so very different. We shall have to make a push for it, and do something or other. The cold is too awful for anything, and the snow will soon be too deep for us to wade through." He peered about him and considered. "Look here," he went on, "this is what occurs to me. There's a sort of dell down here in front of us, where the ground seems all hilly and humpy and hummocky. We'll make our way down into that, and try and find some sort of shelter, a cave or hole with a dry floor to it, out of the snow and the wind, and there we'll have a good rest before we try again, for we're both of us pretty dead beat. Besides, the snow may leave off, or something may turn up." So once more they got on their feet and struggled down into the dell, where they hunted about for a cave or some corner that was dry and a protection from the keen wind and the whirling snow. They were investigating one of the hummocky bits the rat had spoken of, when suddenly the mole tripped up and fell forward on his face with a squeal. "Oh, my leg!" he cried. "Oh, my poor shin!" And he sat up on the snow and nursed his leg in both his front paws. "Poor old mole," said the rat kindly. "You don't seem to be having much luck today, do you? Let's have a look at the leg." "Yes," he went on, going down on his knees to look, "you've cut your shin, sure enough. Wait till I get at my handkerchief, and I'll tie it up for you." The rat, after carefully tying up the leg, had left Mole and was busy scraping in the snow. He scratched and shoveled and explored, all four legs working busily, while the mole waited impatiently, remarking at intervals, "Oh, come on, rat." Suddenly the rat cried, "Hooray!" Then, "Hooray, hooray, hooray, hooray!" and fell to executing a feeble jig in the snow. "What have you found, Ratty?" asked the mole, still nursing his leg. "Come and see," said the delighted rat as he jigged on. The mole hobbled up to the spot and had a good look. "Well," he said at last, slowly, "I see it right enough. Seen the same sort of thing before, lots of times. Familiar object, I call it. A door scraper." "Well, what of it? Why dance jigs around a door scraper?" "But don't you see what it means, you dull-witted animal?" cried the rat impatiently. "Of course I see what it means," replied the mole. "It simply means that some very careless and forgetful person has left his door scraper lying about in the middle of the wild wood, just where it's sure to trip everybody up. Very thoughtless of him, I call it. When I get home, I shall go and complain about it to somebody or other. See if I don't." "Now look here, you thick-headed beast," replied the rat, really angry. "This must stop. Not another word, but scrape, scrape, and scratch, and dig, and hunt round, especially on the sides of the hummocks, if you want to sleep dry and warm tonight, for it's our last chance." The rat attacked a snowbank beside them with ardor, probing with his cudgel everywhere and then digging with fury, and the mole scraped busily too, more to oblige the rat than for any other reason, for his opinion was that his friend was getting light-headed. Some 10 minutes' hard work, and the point of the rat's cudgel struck something that sounded hollow. He worked till he could get a paw through and feel, then called the mole to come and help him. Hard at it went the two animals, till at last the result of their labors stood full in view of the astonished and hitherto incredulous mole. In the side of what had seemed to be a snowbank stood a solid-looking little door, painted a dark green. An iron bell-pull hung by the side, and below it, on a small brass plate, neatly engraved in square capital letters, they could read by the aid of moonlight, "Mr. Badger."